Hello everybody, Tyranno here, and welcome back to another episode of my proposed International Tank Tech Tree series. Now, in today's episode, we're going to be looking at potential Canadian vehicles that could be incorporated into the International Tank Tech Tree. Now, Canada didn't really have many tanks before World War II. It had a couple of old American World War I tanks, but it hadn't really built tanks before. But it was a bit, unlike Australia, which we looked at a few episodes ago, it was a bit more industrialised, so it was able to produce them more readily than some other Commonwealth countries. Canada itself provided a vital role during the war. It actually had, out of some like a population of 11 million people, 10 million people, about a million served in the Canadian Armed Forces. That's about 10%, give or take. Which is just ridiculous. It also, if I'm reading some of these sources right, had the 4th largest air force and 5th largest naval surface fleet in the world at the end of the war. Canadian forces also fought in pretty much every theatre of war. They fought in the Pacific, they fought in Italy, in the Mediterranean, in Europe. On D-Day, of the 5 beaches, Canada actually had charge of Juno Beach, where primarily Canadian troops stormed the beaches, and they actually got the farthest of any of the landing forces, farther than troops at Utah, Omaha, Gold, Sword. So they were very tough fighters, and they could do, and they did very well and gave great service during the war. They were also primarily responsible for liberating much of the Netherlands. Canada itself was also attacked when fire balloons launched by the Japanese actually reached Canada. Fortunately, there was no casualties. There was also an attack by the Japanese submarine I-26, which shelled a lighthouse on Vancouver Island. Canada also contributed economically, for example, providing rare materials, building weapons for the other allies. The Canadian military pattern truck, for example, something like 500,000 of them were built for Canadian and Allied troops. After the war, Canada became one of the founding members of the North Atlantic Treaty Organisation, or NATO. So that's a little background knowledge of Canada in this period of history. And like I said, they contributed massively to the Allied cause, in industry, men, equipment, you know, all sorts of things. But now that we've got all that out of the way, we'll get straight into the episode. Now, the first Canadian tank we're going to look at is the cruiser tank Ram. In 1940, after the Battle of France, Britain had lost most of its tank force. It had either been destroyed or abandoned during the evacuation from Dunkirk. And in June 1940, the British government approached the Canadian railway industry and asked them if they could produce Valentine tanks for Britain. And not long after this, there was an order placed for Canadian Valentine infantry tanks for the Canadian Armoured Division. However, the Valentine tank was an infantry tank, and Canada still needed a cruiser tank to go along with this. Infantry tanks in British doctrine were basically heavily armoured, slow-moving tanks to support the infantry, while the cruiser tanks were fast, lightly armoured tanks which were to exploit breakthroughs created by the slower-moving infantry tanks. As I said at the beginning of the video, Canada didn't really have tank manufacturing capability, so this had to be developed while the tank itself was being designed. Now, at first, it was considered to build the M3 medium tank, which was being produced for Britain at the time, but unfortunately, the main disadvantage of this tank was that the main armament was in the side sponson, the 75mm gun. So it was decided to take, quoting from my book World War II, The Directory of Weapons, the main mechanical hull and transmission components of the M3, but ally them to a new turret mounting a 75mm gun. But there was no prospect of a 75mm gun at the time, so the readily available 40mm weapon was chosen for the initial installations, with the chance of fitting a larger gun later. This turned out to be the 6-pounder 57mm gun, unquote. Now, one of my other books, the Illustrated Encyclopedia of Military Vehicles, goes into this in a bit more detail. Apparently, they could have put the 6-pounder gun on straight away, but this went into opposition because, well, basically all cruiser tanks had 2-pounder guns, so the Ram tank obviously had to have a 2-pounder gun, even though it's smaller and weaker. And the first 50 actually had this. It actually mentions in the next passage that they only put the 6-pounder gun version into production, quote, as soon as sanity had prevailed. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the turret was designed to take a 75mm gun, but there wasn't any available at the time. But when they were available, they actually decided not to fit them with the 75mm gun. And the reason for this was that the 6-pounder actually is better anti-tank work. I didn't realise this, and I was looking through my books, so I actually triple-checked, and they all gave about 70mm at 60 degrees. Now, this confused me because that sort of penetration capacity is better than pretty much every American tank gun all the way up to Tier 5. But I actually found a way of comparing the performance of the 75mm and the 6-pounder in-game. The Soviet premium Su-57 is armed with a 57mm cannon, M1 cannon, which is basically a British 6-pounder gun built in America with a slightly different carriage. So I compared the penetration characteristics of the two guns, with armour-piercing and armour-piercing capped, ballistic capped, and the 57mm gun, 6-pounder, basically wins out at all ranges, at all angles. The only place the 75mm is better is with armour-piercing at about 1,000 metres. That is literally the only way the 75mm is better. And with armour-piercing at 500 metres at 0 degrees, the 6-pounder is something like 20mm more penetration, at 30 degrees, 18. Basically, it's better than the 75mm in every possible way, except for that one example at 1,000 metres at 60 degree angle. Now, moving on to the armour, this is a bit harder to work out. The Illustrated Encyclopedia of Military Vehicles says 13 to 76mm of armour. My other book, World War II, The Directory of Weapons, says it's about 25 to 89mm of armour. Meanwhile, Wikipedia says it's 25 to 85mm, and TanksEncyclopedia.com just says 87 maximum. I don't know where the discrepancies come from. It's possible there are some upgrade in armour between the Mark 1 and Mark 2. Like I said, the Illustrated Encyclopedia seems to be a bit of an outlier. So I believe the armour is in the upper 80s, 80mm, but I don't know what the exact maximum thickness is. I believe it's also the turret. We know the lower hull from the M3 Grant already in-game is about 50mm. So I'm guessing most of that additional armour is going to be around the turret and upper hull, but again, I don't know for definite because I can't find any information on it. Now, one other thing I should point out with regards to armour, the early models did have some sort of machine gun turret on the front of the hull. It was some sort of leftover design flaw from early British cruiser designs, and it was a bit of a armour weakness. It caused all sorts of problems. It was removed in later models, but it could cause some problems with regards to armour and penetration in the early variants of the Ram, such as the Ram Mark 1. With regards to speed, pretty much all of my sources agree it was about 25 miles per hour top speed, and crew, there was about 5 crew. If I'm correct, it was a driver, commander, gunner, loader, and some sort of bow machine gunner in the later models, or the turret machine gunner in the early models. So where should these tanks go on the tech tree? Now, I've split it up into the two different marks, the Mark 1 with the 40mm and the Mark 2 with the 57mm. Now, the Mark 1 with the 2-pounder gun, the 40mm, my book, The World War II, The Directory of Weapons, says it could do about 53mm at around 500m. It actually has the same muzzle velocity, penetration at 500m, and a very similar projectile weight to the M5 cannon on the M3 Stuart. Now, the Stuart's a battle rating of 1.3, but it also has very similar characteristics or penetration characteristics to the Panzer III F&J with the KWK-38 50mm cannon. Now, the Panzer IIIs with the KWK-38 50mm cannons are battle rating 2.3. The Ram has the, you know, a similar gun, or a gun with similar characteristics, but it has very thick armour. So I think it should be battle rating 3, perhaps? I know that seems a bit high, but if I put it lower, its armour's just going to be a massive problem for, you know, lower tier tanks, or lower battle rating tanks. But at 3, its armour should be able to protect it well enough. It will have a pretty okay gun, and 3.3 is where the Germans get their F2, and their 3.7 is where the T-34 1942 comes into play, or 3.3 for the T-34 1941, so they'll be able to deal with the Ram, hopefully. To put it in context, the KV-1 L-11 is tier 2 battle rating 3.7. It has slightly less armour, or frontal armour, 75mm, so this seems the fairest place to put the Ram Mark 1, at least. Now, for the Ram Mark 2, well, we know the 6-pounder gun's better at destroying tanks than the Sherman 75mm, and the 75mm Shermans go up to a maximum of battle rating of 4.3. Again, this is really hard to decide a battle rating for it. I think battle rating 4 is the best I can think of at the moment, or it's a bit below the 75mm M4A2 Sherman, which is the top 75mm Sherman battle rating wise. It would go against Sherman's with 75mm guns then. It would go against KV-1 L-11s quite regularly. They'd be a little bit lower. It should be going against T-34 1942s and STZs. And Germany, it would probably be going against Panzer IV F-2s or Panzer IV Gs. So its armour wouldn't be massively overpowered, and its guns should be able to do well at those tiers and battle ratings. Again, it's a really hard decision to come to, and I'm sure people will disagree in the comments with my battle ratings, but I honestly cannot think of a better way to do it. So that was the cruiser tank Ram, and like with the Australians, the Canadians had built a very good tank that was in many ways superior to contemporary British and even American designs. But in the end, it was never used in combat. Basically, there was just enough Shermans to go around for all the other Allied nations. So as part of standardisation, the Canadian units were equipped with the Sherman tank. And plus, while the cruiser tank Ram may have had a better gun for dealing with enemy tanks, it wasn't so good at dealing with enemy infantry. It didn't really have a very good high explosive shell, something that the Sherman 75mm gun did. So the Sherman was there in greater numbers. It helped make logistics a lot simpler, and it was a better all-round tank for dealing with enemy infantry and enemy tanks, whereas the Ram was just much better at dealing with enemy tanks. However, this wasn't the end for the cruiser tank Ram. Many were actually sent to the UK to equip Canadian Armoured Divisions for training, and when they were finished with training, they were converted to other uses, for example an armoured personnel carrier, command tanks, for artillery units, and the chassis was used for the Sexton self-propelled gun, which we'll be looking at in a little bit. However, this still wasn't the end for the cruiser tank Ram, at least in its gun tank form, because many were actually sent to the Netherlands. According to Ironside's Canadian Armoured Fighting Vehicle Museums and Monuments, the Dutch Army got permission from the Canadian government to take Ram tanks that were in dumps on Dutch territory. Some of them must have been sent to the Netherlands as gun tanks for whatever reason. But even more interestingly, in 1947, quoting here, the UK provided 44 Ram tanks from its stocks that were in better condition. 40 of these had been rebuilt for the British 75mm gun. So Britain had gone to the trouble of actually putting the 75mm gun in at some point, in semi-decent numbers, which I don't know why they did that. It seemed, after they'd already agreed they weren't going to use it as a gun tank, so why they then rebuilt it with a 75mm gun, I do not know. Maybe the Ram tank with the 75mm gun could be put in the Netherlands part of the tech tree, because it doesn't seem like Britain actually used the Ram tanks with the 75mm guns. I sort of get the impression they were in storage, and Holland, or the Netherlands, I don't think actually used them in combat, but I think they did put a few in, in place fortifications. They basically got the hole, buried it in concrete, so just the turret was sticking out. And maybe it could be used in some alternate history events involving the Netherlands, so I may include that in the Dutch part of the tech tree. But overall, the Ram tank was a very good tank. Maybe a little bit too late to be useful because the Sherman came about, but I think if the Americans hadn't got involved in the war, or if they got involved a bit later and the Ram was actually used as a gun tank, I think it would have been a pretty good tank. Now, the next tank we're looking at is the Grizzly Cruiser tank. Now, there's actually two variants we're going to be looking at, one with a 75mm gun and one with a 17-pounder gun. But we're going to start with the 75mm gun version first. Now, this is basically a Canadian-built M4A1 Sherman, but with some minor and some major differences. It uses the same gun as the early variant Shermans, the 75mm gun. It's got the same crew, commander, gunner, loader, driver, co-driver slash hole gunner. Has about the same speed, 24 miles per hour. The differences between the Grizzly and the Sherman tanks are to do with the tracks and the armour. With the tracks, it uses Canadian dry pin tracks, which are a bit lighter and don't use rubber, which was harder to get a hold of because a lot of it comes from Southeast Asia, where Japan had invaded a lot of countries and territories. But the most interesting change is to do with the armour, which is, according to Ironsides, which I quoted earlier, and my other online sources, sloped to a higher degree than the normal Sherman and also has thicker armour. Unfortunately, none of the sources say where the extra armour is. I would have thought it would be around the hull, but I've heard some suggestions that it's around the right cheek of the turret, which seems like a really odd place to put extra armour, like a pretty specific place as well. So unfortunately, I can't say for certain where the additional armour is on the Grizzly Cruiser tank. But the additional sloping is a massive help. At the moment, the front of the M4A1 is between 70mm effective thickness and about 100, depending on where you shoot. And that's sloped at between 48 degrees and about 60, depending on where you shoot. So additional sloping should manage to boost that up, you know, probably from the 70s up to the 80s minimum. So that's, you know, quite a massive improvement. Now, the other variant I wanted to talk about is basically a Grizzly Cruiser tank, but with a 17-pounder gun. Again, according to Ironsides, some of these were produced and used for training, but never used in combat. So I've sort of bolded and underlined it because I don't know if it should be added, but the 17-pounder is one of the best guns of the war, so that's a massive firepower boost for this tank and for the international tank tech tree as a whole. So where should these tanks go on the tech tree? Now, the 75mm Shermans go up to battle rating 4.3 and then it jumps to battle rating 5 for the M4A1 Sherman with the 76mm gun. Now, I think the Grizzly tank with the 75mm gun could go at battle rating 4.3 or 4.7. This puts it in before the 76mm guns and around the same battle rating as the M4A2 Sherman. Now, this has 63mm of armour, but it's sloped at 47 degrees, which gives it an effective thickness of around 90 to 80, depending where you shoot it. The Grizzly tank should have more sloped armour and potentially thicker armour, so that should make it, you know, more armoured than the M4A2 Sherman, or at least about the same armour effectiveness. So it could go, like I said, either 4.3 or 4.7. For the 17-pounder version, I think it should go 6.7, very possibly 6.3. If it goes any lower than 6.3, you know, 6 or something, it would be going against the Tiger 1s, and it would absolutely slaughter them. 6.3 would put it above the early Tigers, and nearer the Tiger 2s. 6.7s will put it at the same level as the Tiger 2s. I think that's pretty much the best place to put it. Yeah, like I said, possibly 6.3, depending on how Gaijin feel about the tank and all that, and the gun. Yeah, I think that's a pretty good place to put it. 6.7, 6.3, preferably 6.7 though. So that was the Cruiser Grizzly tank, and it actually ended up sharing a similar fate to the Ram tank. Basically, it wasn't needed. Enough Shermans were being built in America to be given to pretty much all of the Allied nations. They only built a few hundred of these, and a lot of them were actually given to Portugal, who were using them up till the 70s or 80s, I think. I've heard somewhere that most of the, or a lot of the surviving Shermans around today are the Grizzly variant. I don't know how true that is, but that would be, you know, quite a significant thing, considering only a few hundred are actually built. They did use the chassis for various other things. Some ended up being used for the Sexton self-propelled gun, some ended up being used for the Skink self-propelled anti-aircraft vehicle or tank. So yeah, it was a pretty good tank, just wasn't particularly needed. But again, it showed Canada could make and design and build, you know, pretty good tanks if needed. Now, the next vehicle we're looking at is the Bren carrier with a 2-pounder gun. Now, this could actually go as in either the Australian part of the tech tree or the Canadian. Both nations built Bren carriers with 2-pounder guns, and as far as I'm aware, they both used them only for training. But like I said, it is basically a Bren carrier with a 2-pounder gun on it. Now, as I said, the armament is a 2-pounder gun. Armour, I believe the armour is about 7 to 10mm. I don't believe they changed it for these 2-pounder conversions. Speed is about 30 miles an hour. Crew, my books say it had a crew of 2 as a Bren carrier, and online sources say 3. I'm assuming there would have been 3 crew for the gun, so, you know, something like commander, loader, gunner, plus driver and maybe a wireless operator or something like that. I don't know where the other crewmen came from on the regular Bren carrier, so between 5 and 6 crew, probably. So where would this go on the tech tree? There's not actually many tier 1 tank destroyers to compare it to. There's only the M3 GMC and the Stug-3A. The Russians actually don't have a tier 1 tank destroyer anymore. They all got moved up to tier 2 or above. I'd say possibly 2, very possibly 1.3. 2 seems the best place for it. That would put it 0.3 below the M3 GMC and the Stug-3A. Really, but like I said, it's got similar penetration to the M3 Stuart, so it's not going to be too overpowered. The M3 Stuart's at 1.3. This is going to be a little bit higher. I think 1.7 would be the best place for it. You know, it would be able to do okay at that level, which wouldn't be completely slaughtered, but it wouldn't be completely overpowered. So yeah, that seems like the best place for it, and it would be good to have this vehicle in the tech tree. Now the next vehicle on our list is the Sexton self-propelled gun. Now, according to my books, the British Purchasing Commission had gone to America to sort of, you know, decide what vehicles to buy from the Americans, and they quite liked the M7 Priest, which was a self-propelled gun with a 105mm howitzer. But they didn't want the 105mm howitzer, not because it was a bad gun, but, you know, logistical problems. So Britain wanted something that could take their own gun, in this case the 25-pounder gun. So the Americans went away and they produced something called the T-51, which was basically an M7 with a 25-pounder gun. Now my sources disagree on why this wasn't built. Some say the Americans refused to build it because they weren't going to use it themselves. Some say the Americans were just too busy to build it. You know, they had all their production facilities building their own vehicles. And some of the online sources say that the prototype just didn't work, including a situation where the gun was destroyed during the prototype testing. Knowing they weren't going to be getting a 25-pounder M7 Priest anytime soon, Britain went to the Canadians. Remember, the Ram tank at this point had just been put into production, but was already slated to be replaced by the M4 Sherman. So there was already a production line for the Ram tank that wasn't going to be used anymore, so they just altered the design and, you know, came up with the Sexton self-propelled gun. This became the Sexton 1. They actually produced a Sexton 2, another variant, which was basically the same but based on the cruiser tank Grizzly hull instead of the Ram. Now, most of my sources agree the armour was maximum 32mm, but one of my books, the Illustrated Encyclopedia of Military Vehicles, says it went up to 108mm. I'm going to assume that's a typo, or wildly false. I don't know if maybe they're looking at the Grizzly tank chassis or hull, because that did have thicker armour than the regular Shermans, but even then, I think that must be wrong, because that's, you know, thicker than most battle tanks. Speed was about 25 miles an hour, so decently fast, and it had a crew of 6. Now, I know for definite that's probably going to be a driver, gunner, commander and loader. The other two, looking online, they say it's more to do with the artillery role of the vehicle, gun layers, wireless operators, that sort of stuff, so they may not be needed so much in the vehicle, but they can replace other crew members when they're knocked out or knocked unconscious. So where should this go on the tech tree? Well, that's actually quite hard to work out, because none of my books list any armour penetration figures, and some of the online ones may not be right. I've seen one that says at 350 metres, it can 0 degrees, it can do 70 millimetres. Another source says at 30 degrees, it can do 62mm at 500 metres and 54 at 1000. When I did my episode on Australian tanks, I actually said the Sentinel AC3 with a 25-pounder gun should be between 4.3 and 4.7, although that had a lot more armour. One thing that does help a little bit is the Stur-42G, which is basically a Stug-3 with a 105mm howitzer. Now, I think the 25-pounder is a little bit superior to the Stur-42G, but not by much. So I think a battle rating of between 3.7 and 4.3 would be best for the Sexton. I mean, it was used as an anti-tank gun in real life, so it must have some, you know, capability of destroying tanks. And that battle rating would lead it to go against Panzer IVs and Panzer IIIs. Maybe some of the early Sherman variants as well, and possibly some early variants of the T-34. T-34 1942 is 3.7, KV-1 L-11 is 3.7, so I think that's the best battle rating for it, at least until I can get more reliable facts and figures about the anti-tank capabilities of the 25-pounder gun. Now, the last vehicle on our list is the Skink SPAA, or Self-Propelled Anti-Aircraft Gun. Now, there are pictures of it, but they're all sort of behind copyright, and I don't want to get in trouble, so I'll link you to where you can find those pictures. But basically, it was a design for a self-propelled anti-aircraft gun, based on the chassis of the Grizzly tank. Now, using online sources, because none of my books list it, it has four 20mm cannons. These were originally going to be Hispano Suiza cannons, but they eventually changed it to the 20mm Poulston cannons. Armour was okay, 50mm maximum, speed of about 24 miles per hour, and a crew of four. I'm guessing it's going to be driver, loader, gunner, commander, or something along those lines. Now, changing the cannons from Hispano cannons to the Poulston cannons delayed the project quite a bit, and by the time it was ready, there was just no need for the vehicle. The Luftwaffe had basically been wiped out over northwest Europe. They just didn't need a self-propelled anti-aircraft vehicle. Three of them were produced in the end, and one was actually sent to Britain and then on to the Canadian units fighting in France. And again, it wasn't used in its actual intended role of shooting down aircraft. But with four 20mm cannons, it was still pretty useful against enemy infantry and other soft targets. So where should this go on the tech tree? Well, the most similar vehicle, or pretty much the only similar vehicle to the Skink, is the Flak Panzer IV Verbalwind, which is at Tier 3, battle rating 3.7. So I think the Skink should go 3.7, possibly 3.3. I think it's got slightly less armour than the Verbalwind, so maybe that could lead it to it being put down a little bit in the battle rating, but 3.7 is fine, possibly 3.3. And I think it would be a nice, useful little self-propelled anti-aircraft vehicle for the Tier 3. It's pretty much the only one I've got, it is the only one I've got at Tier 3, so I think it would be a nice, useful vehicle at that tier. Not too overpowered, but not, you know, too weak either. So now that we've looked at potential Canadian vehicles that could be added into War Thunder, how could Canada itself be added into the game via events and such? Well, we know some of the vehicles, such as the Sexton, were used in quite large numbers, so you could use your regular bog standard events, such as a D-Day invasions, fighting across Europe, to incorporate some Canadian vehicles. Others such as the Ram, the Skink, or the cruiser tank Grizzly, and possibly the 2-pounder Bren carrier, you may need alternate reality events for those. For example, maybe having America not join the war, or join the war much later to give a reason for the Ram tank to be incorporated in events. You know, if America wasn't in the war, the Ram tank presumably would have gone into full production. You could also have maybe an event where the American factories have been sabotaged, or so they've had to rely on the cruiser tank Grizzly more. Maybe the Bren carrier was taken out of training, perhaps because Canada itself was invaded, perhaps by Axis powers in some sort of Wolfenstein the New Order type scenario, or Japan invading Western Canada, maybe even America itself joining the Axis and invading from the south, which is far-fetched, but again, the excuse to give somebody's vehicles a reason to be in-game. The Skink could be incorporated, perhaps because the German Luftwaffe introduced jets a lot earlier and didn't lose air superiority so easily. You know, perhaps they're still a threat, so the Skink is put into service. So there are lots of ways that Canadian vehicles that weren't used in combat could be incorporated into War Thunder events. So that's it for today's longer than usual episode. The next episode will either be China or Czechoslovakia. I may need to get some more information on the Chinese tanks, so I may, you know, rename it People's Republic of China, because I haven't been able to find anything for the nationalist side of China so far. So I may go to Czechoslovakia. It depends how much information I can find on Chinese tanks. But anyway, I hope you've enjoyed today's episode. Leave a like if you did. Subscribe if you like these sorts of videos. Leave feedback. Could always do with more feedback. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.